Today we're going to talk about valuing card games. What I mean when I talk about a card's value, I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about the internal math that a game must follow to stay competitive, fun, and fair. Once you know what to look for, you'll see it everywhere. But for real, understanding these mathematical systems that designers use can be hugely helpful for TCG players. It will help you get a beat on a card's power level right away, which is important for limited draft formats, deck building with a new set, or transferring experience from one TCG to another. In any large TCG, designers have to create thousands of cards. That's not possible without a baseline. Value exists because designers need a starting point, a default expectation, so new cards land close to the balance before testing. That baseline is the game's value math. You can spot it by looking for an average, no-frills card and see what it does for its cost or commitment. Hearthstone is a great starting point because it is clear. Mana is consistent, uncolored, and converts directly into board impact. If something is off-rate, you'll feel it immediately. While other games like Magic, you could fall behind because you're in a mana screwed, in Hearthstone, as long as you're on curve, you'll be able to use up your mana and generate board value. The easiest way to find the baseline rule is to look at the most boring cards. River Croc has 5 points of stats for 2 points of mana, and the Yeti has 9 points of stats for 4 points of mana. In Hearthstone, this rule is quite simple. 1 mana equals 2 points of stats, and each card gives you plus 1 point. Cards that break the curve have text that offsets the value equation. Even so, it's hard to find cards that break beyond the value rule. This is because Hearthstone designers wanted to keep the game dead simple and straightforward. It ensures that in any given turn, players should be putting down around the same total value stats. Marvel Snap was also created by Ben Brode, the same guy who designed Hearthstone, and so it's no surprise that it operates on the same simple plus one mana per turn formula as Hearthstone. It almost operates on the same simple math equation, one mana equals two power. The difference, the fact that each card has a premium of one in Hearthstone, helps us understand the dynamics of how to maximize value in each game. In Hearthstone, cards are valued at a premium because hand size is small at the start of the game. We want to play out cards on curve because yeeting everything early game means you would lose flexibility of choosing a card from hand. However, we do get a bonus in terms of value. Because of that, in Hearthstone, there are some rush/swarm decks that do this. Playing out lots of lower cost cards means you're going to take advantage of that plus one premium, gaining one value for every card put out each turn. With the trade-off being that you lose agency, you end up only having one or two cards in hand to play with. In Marvel Snap, a card's gameplay value is determined by how efficiently it converts energy into power density under space constraints. You only have three lanes and four slots per lane, so value is not just raw power, it's how much power a card produces per slot, per lane, and relative to location rules. A one-cost card that becomes seven power is massively over the baseline because it compresses into a single slot. Snap cards look weak in isolation, but become efficient when locations or synergies multiply their input. The math lives in density and multipliers, not just curve. Ultimately, Marvel Snap cards are about maximizing your value across the limited real estate of the four slots in a location. And so synergistic combos that break the value curve are the most valuable cards in the game. And then there's the brilliantly fun mind game style cards that reward you for predicting your opponent's game plan. But I digress. That's a topic for another video. For now, let's jump from the lanes of Snap into the lanes of Rift. In typical Riot fashion, Riftbound builds directly on the same concept as Snap, but adds complexity to how value resolves. Like Snap, the goal is to control multiple locations that modify the value of cards. A player must choose where to place their cards in order to maximize its value. In Riftbound, however, instead of power being checked only at the end of the game, value compounds over time. A unit that survives generates pressure. That means value isn't just where you play, it's how long your investment stays alive. The math becomes pressure per lane multiplied by time. Trying to figure out this universal equation of Riftbound value in terms of numbers is somewhat unrealistic, given that all the variables that come into play. So let's take a step back and just look at the basic units' mana-power relationships. When we look at some basic spells and units, we can see how it follows a similar relationship to Hearthstone and Snap. Rather than the average of attack and defense equaling the card's cost, in Riftbound it's just one stat, might. Riftbound also adds complexity to the simpler mana system of Ben's games. There are two ways to use your mana, tapping it or recycling it into the mana deck. That gives players the option to sacrifice future value in order to get something powerful on the board now. For units, this usually represents a bonus utility ability, which we can see here comparing Vanguard Sergeant to Renata. The power cost gives you this extra passive for trading in a rune. Same thing for these two. The might stays in line with the cost curve, and the additional utility helps trade future ramp for a situational boost. In spells, however, that recycle cost represents a significant trade-off. You cash in two runes of ramp for a temporary ability rather than just a unit which stays on the board. Riot may have overtuned this trade-off, though. Cards like Falling Star can completely break down your opponent's game plan. Riftbound's mana system is likely an evolution of the Don deck, which is one of the most elegant pieces of One Piece trading card game's mechanics. Recycling Dawn is a feature of the purple color in One Piece. It is themed around Dawn manipulation with cards that add Dawn or ramp and others that recycle it. It's no wonder that Kai'Sa is the current queen of the Riftbound meta. Ask any One Piece player and they tell you purple has been one of the most consistently powerful colors in One Piece. I love comparing games and tracing these lines of influence and inspiration. Subscribe for a future video where I'll trace elements of different TCGs from one game to another. Back to One Piece. The card value in One Piece has added complexity because of the multifunctionality of the cards. Cards can be discarded during your opponent's turn as a way to counter the opponent's incoming attacks. Each 2k counter usually equates to minus 1k power or plus 1 cost, in exchange for utility in the form of hand smoothing and survivability. General deck building guidelines suggest a certain number of 2k counters per deck archetype. 8 to 10 is for aggro, 12 to 14 for control, etc. The rule for One Piece tends to be power equals cost plus 1. Times 1,000, because obviously anything with 1,000, it's 1,000 times better. The standard is to have a 1k counter and some form of utility ability. Cards that lack any ability usually get a bonus 1k in power or have a 2k counter. Because 1k counter is the norm, cards that lack any counter are rare and usually skew towards the higher cost cards and are overrated. These bombs often are deck identity cards, and they have the power to swing a game in your favor if you're able to play them out at the right time. There's also Trigger, an ability which can be activated when an opponent deals damage to your life. This effect offsets a card's onboard value somewhat, but Trigger is more linked to deck identity than pure value, especially linked to the color yellow. Using the same "how did the designers think about this" style of interrogation, my instinct about the goal with Trigger was that they would spread it out amongst cards, that it would be a fun source of randomness and deck identity for some, rather than a serious deck building consideration. Okay, so now that we're starting to get into the weeds and some of the multifunctional cards, Flesh and Blood takes the same multifunctional system to the next level. FAB system is so sophisticated because not only do cards get discarded to defend, they can also be pitched to pay for the cost of other cards. That means that all value in the game ultimately comes from cards inside your deck. Attack, defense, and pitch are just different ways of spending that same underlying value. Nothing is generated externally, and so each turn is about optimizing your use of the cards in your hand. Each card in FAB has an average total value of 8. If you add the pitch value, the attack value, and the defense value, and then subtract the cost, usually you get 8. Often there is some sort of value attributed to the text on the card, which you would add, but not for CNC, which is why it's probably one of the most powerful cards in FAB. Many of FAB's cards also exist in multiple forms or cycles. The same card exists in red, yellow, and blue pitch versions. Each pitch version has a different trade-off, usually one less attack per point of pitch value. Knowing this equation helps us identify an important choice in deck building. We are in control of the resource curve. How much damage are we willing to give up in order to make sure we have the resources to pay out our cards? FAB players use a hypergeometric calculator in order to account for the probability of drawing their resource base and to track the cost versus resources in their deck while deck building, to ensure that they are able to pay for the cards in their deck. Each card in FAB has an expected value of 3. Like how the baseline for most cards is 1k counter in One Piece, the baseline for blocking in FAB is 3. So between the 3 value from blocking or pitching a blue, it's usually fairly easy to convert a card into 3 points of value. Our goal when building a deck is to convert cards into greater than 3 points of value, which requires smart sequencing and experience. For example, if we're creating a deck like Syndra or Aurora that can run a majority of red cards, Ravenous Rabble can reliably convert to 4 damage and go again. If we follow that up with a CNC, we must pitch a card to pay for the CNC, and we will be able to do 6 damage, spending 2 cards to get 3 value each. However, if the CNC text comes into play, we might destroy the opponent's arsenal, meaning they miss out on expected 3 value, bringing our total value to 9. For 3 cards, that would mean we get a total of 13 value, over 4 value per card. This math isn't abstract theory, it's a practical tool. Without a value model, large card pools collapse under power creep and randomness. Baselines let designers estimate whether a card is close enough to fair before it ever hits a playtest. Different games choose different baselines, but all of them need one. Knowing this baseline must exist, and understanding that a game's base value math lets you transfer skill between games. When you move to a new TCG, you don't need to just know every card. You need to just recalibrate the baseline. Once you know what an average card does for its cost, you can quickly judge whether something represents a real threat or an inefficient play, or a synergy-dependent setup. This directly helps with deck building, and even with interpreting the opponent's commitments, even when you don't know the full card pool.